Okay, what is the latest on Filipinos in Gaza as of the moment? I mean, how many remain in critical areas and how many more are waiting for passage through the Rafah crossing? This is just for Gaza for now.
Well, we've come to a situation that everywhere is critical because you've heard in the news, you broadcasted it, that there are, of course, the southern part is where it's supposed to be safer, but our Kababayan herself, we heard her, is saying that they're hearing airstrikes. Okay. It's not as bad as in northern Gaza. By the way, we'd like to correct something we've been saying. We've been saying all Filipinos have been evacuated to the south. There are apparently still three Filipino nationals in Gaza City, including a father and child who are at the Al-Quds Hospital.
All right.
That's a concern.
All right. Is there any effort to take them out of the area today?
No, well, they're in the hospital, so we can't just take them out. So what the Philippines and other nations are doing is to call for, join the call of the UN Secretary General, Antonio Guterres, for civilian lives to be protected.
All right. In the meantime, what kind of support are they getting while they are in hospital?
We're trying to make humanitarian aid reach Gaza, calling for that as well. So hopefully every resident of Gaza, including foreign nationals, could be given protection, could be given this assistance. From what we understand, the Filipino father, a Filipino has citizenship, but it's a Palestinian-born child of a Filipina.
Okay.
So remember, out of 136 Filipino nationals, only a few are actually from the Philippines, but they are Philippine nationals, so we count them.
And have you been in touch with the family of these Filipinos that are trapped now in a hospital?
Our embassy is in touch, yes. Our embassy, Amman, yes, in touch. All right, so let's hope that they're able to start crossing the border, the other Filipinos who are now in the south, hopefully by the weekend.
Okay, by the weekend. Now, Yusek De Vega, what are the chances that we can get our nationals out of Gaza with a delay in the supposed ground attacks by Israel on Hamas positions? I mean, how critical is this lull, if you will, to get the most favorable results in this dilemma that we have with those who are trapped, particularly Filipinos, still there?
Well, of course, it's some benefit, if you can call it that, that there are no ground assaults yet. Of course, there are the air attacks. But the fact that there are no ground assaults would indicate that there is some talk on the ground. And many countries have been talking to other nations as well about releasing hostages or final arrangements for the allowing Filipinos and other foreign nationals to exit through the Rafah crossing. So every day that there's no entry, ground assault should be considered some positive indication that efforts are on the ground. The UN Secretary General himself was there, and there have been hostages released. So it's not that it's an ideal situation, not at all.
Okay.
But at the very least, there's hope.
Okay, and at least we're buying time. Now, Yusek De Vega, are there still missing Filipinos that were reported to you? And have we confirmed if there are indeed Filipinos among those taken hostage?
There's still two missing Filipinos. One is an Israeli passport holder, a lady. The gentleman, we cannot confirm 100%, but we are taking it as if he was a hostage. Because all indications are that he was taken. The Filipino wife saw it on the video. And so we hope that eventually they will be released as well.
Okay, so at least one Filipino there.
It's a lack of hostage.
Okay,
but
likely, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. There are also Filipinos in Israel who have expressed a willingness to come home. How is the government processing these requests for repatriation for those who are in Israel and not in Gaza?
Well, those in Israel are leaving in batches. So we've had three batches arrive, totaling 59 persons. It's a whole of government approach. So Tel Aviv, our embassy in Tel Aviv, does have a map workers attaché, and they're working on this. Before the end of the month, there'll be another batch.
Okay, how critical is the situation for Filipinos in Israel? Must they leave, really?
Well, no, it's alert level 2. Mm-hmm. They are quite, meaning no new deployment,
okay.
But we are not asking them to leave, but those who wish to leave are certainly being assisted, not just by the DFA, DMW, OWA, but other government agencies once they arrive. So they are leaving by commercial flight. So it's not anywhere near the situation in Gaza, for example, because the Israeli Defense Force has retained control of the peace and order situation in Israel.
Okay, now news reports are saying there are 20 Filipinos now in West Bank seeking repatriation as well. What is the advice to them, and is there any indication that alert levels at the West Bank will also be raised based on the situation now?
It's probably going to be raised, although I will not confirm it until we actually raised it. It's currently at alert level 2. And so we might call on voluntary repatriation. And if I may, I just got a report from our ambassador in Jordan, who maintains jurisdiction over the West Bank and Gaza. No, he corrected it. There are four Filipinos who wish to leave the West Bank out of 122 Filipinos. But that is not going to be difficult, because all they need to do, and we're helping them, is to go through Jordan. Okay. And there's no blockade, there's no war going on. So they will be repatriated eventually.
Okay, Yusek De Vega, let's talk about Palestinian Filipino spouses now and their families who may wish to flee. What is the plan for these individuals? They may have decided to stay for now, but at some point, perhaps, if any of them will decide to leave, what help will they get?
First, about Palestinian spouses. The good news is that the Egyptians have been asking details, not just of the Filipino nationals. They've requested again the details of Filipino nationals who are to be allowed into Egypt, in addition to their Palestinian family members now. So that means they are open to allowing the Palestinian spouses. And Palestinian spouses are entitled to a visa if they are coming to the Philippines with their spouses, accompanying the spouses. That's a basic visa rule. As for those who will remain, hopefully there will be a session of hostilities, because this is a cycle which always happens. And then our embassy in Amman will be able better to monitor their condition and provide them assistance, including financial assistance if necessary. Right now, we can't. Right now, there's a total blockade.
Okay, now if they decide, of course, to leave the area, bring their families, their children, and maybe some relatives, what kind of support are we giving them?
Oh, that's being discussed by the government, because they're not OFW, so they don't really qualify for the reintegration program with the DMW, OWA, and other agencies. Mm-hmm. But given that they're Filipino nationals and will have to, in a way, be assisted while they're in the Philippines, there will be assistance given to them. And when they come home, they're still Palestinian residents, which means one day they'll go back.
Yeah.
So they're not coming back for good.
Okay. Tell us now about the areas that you've identified in the critical places there in Israel, Lebanon, the Gaza Strip, and even the West Bank. I understand there have been arrangements between the Philippine government and some shelters there, churches, to take in Filipinos that might be fleeing the conflict areas. What are these arrangements about?
Oh, those are part of the contingency plans that we have at each embassy. But right now, it's more in place in Lebanon.
Okay.
There's still no actual major hostilities going on. I will revise what was mentioned. Now it's 113 who want to leave, not 95. And it goes up by the day.
This is 113 for Lebanon, Filipinos.
For Lebanon
alone.
Lebanon alone, there are 70,000. Okay. And why is that? Why is there a low number? For example, in Israel, 30,000, and so far, at most, maybe 100 will come home. And then Lebanon, similar numbers, because they see the situation as stable as far as they are concerned, and because of economic reasons. However, what we're calling on is for them to voluntarily accept this repatriation program while it's still relatively easy to bring them home because there's no actual facilities and there's flights. Because we have in the past had to repatriate thousands of Filipinos from Lebanon in 2006 when there was a major war. But the contingency plan does call for shelters in place. And in Israel, they are quite used to this situation. And under Israeli regulations, they are also provided protection along with other Israeli residents. They know where to go. They know where the bomb shelters are. And well, lately, as you can see, it's not that much of a concern for those living in major cities in Israel now. It's Lebanon where there is the issue about, you know, the protection. Although one thing we've always called on for Kababayans, don't join mass demonstrations because there would be mass demonstrations. There are, no? So keep safe.
Okay, and now Yusek De Vega, in total now, how many areas are we closely monitoring and where possible evacuations or repatriation of Filipinos can be critical? You already mentioned Lebanon, of course, Gaza, Israel, where else?
So first, there's the Gaza Strip through the Rafah crossing. It's the West Bank and through the entrance with Jordan. By the way, we have successfully brought home, assisted some Filipino tourists in Israel whose flights were canceled and who had to go through alternate means to return to the Philippines. So they went through Jordan, to the West Bank and then Jordan. So that's another a viable place. There is the south of Lebanon.
Okay.
And where there are evacuations of Filipinos to safer places. And, you know, in Israel, right now it's more for a basic repatriation program for Filipinos who, for economic or other reasons, have to go home. So it's the crucial areas are really Gaza and the West Bank and the south of Lebanon.
Okay, the situation there's really volatile. We don't know how long it will last, what kind of war strategy that may transpire in the next couple of days. Yusek, what is the contingency plan now if and when the conflict is prolonged in countries also near Israel, where we have a heavy deployment of migrant workers?
There's a lot of contingency planning involving cooperation with local authorities. I will not go into details because I don't want to put our Kababayans in harm's way because... Precisely, that's why it's a contingency plan. A military strategist won't reveal to the public how they're going to do it, but we can just guarantee that they are in place. And in case there's a major major hostility coming in, we'll perform what we have to do. But that is why in Lebanon itself, we are saying as early as now, if you can go home, please contact the embassy, and they'll book you at Philippine government expense,
okay.
A flight to the Philippines.
As long as they are OFWs, right?
Or overseas, as long as they're Philippine nationals.
Okay, Philippine nationals. Now, for those who are coming home, particularly those migrant workers, what are the basic assistance packages, perhaps, that you will offer to these Kababayans as they reintegrate in the Philippines?
Well, whenever they get home, aside from the ayuda provided by both the DMW and the OWA,
all right.
There are scholarships, scholarships for their student, for their children, and they're provided psychological counseling by DSWD and some medical assistance by the DOH. People, members of Congress also provide them financial assistance when they get home. So that's one. And, well, I could recommend, I could champion Assistant Secretary Veni Legaspi of DMW, who's in charge of this. Quite a hardworking gentleman.
Okay, lastly, Yusek De Vega, we know for a fact that you are swamped with inquiries as well from relatives of Filipinos in Israel and Lebanon who are here in the Philippines. Now, what is your advice? Are there help desks, perhaps, that you've set up for inquiries in your home offices now?
To center it all, there is a hotline number, 1348 of the OWA. And please, if you still have contact with your kamag-anak, especially in Lebanon, do advise them to accept these repatriation programs, this repatriation offer of the Philippines. At the same time, you, especially for those in Israel, they are safe. They are safe. I mean, it's a cycle of violence, which unfortunately happens. But right now, Filipinos in Israel, except for the two missing, you know, they are... you know, they are accounted for. On the other hand, Lebanon, I must add, there is a reason why some of them do not want to go. Yeah. About half of them are not documented. So maybe that's the main reason they want to go home. But that's where health is wealth. Better to be safe. But we'll respect any decision you make. After all, it's just voluntary repatriation now. So we'll do what we can. Nandiyan kami para sa inyo, mga kababayan.
Okay, we'll do what we can. Just an addendum about the undocumented Filipinos. They still enjoy the same benefits in terms of assistance if and when they decide to return to the Philippines?
Yes, because if you look at the law, RA 11641 doesn't make a distinction. Okay. Of course, they're not OWA members, so OWA assistance is not readily available.
Okay.
But the basic packages for returning Filipino workers, it's there, whether they are documented or not. Of course, we still would like future Filipinos leaving the country to go through the process.
All right. On that note, thank you so much, DFA Undersecretary Eduardo De Vega. We know you have a lot on your plate. Good luck. It's been a long month for you.
Good weekend. Buhay Pilipinas. Salamat.